Hey everybody, and welcome to this Q&A. That stands for question and answer, for those of you who don't know, about EAT. Lots of acronyms today.
Yep.
So EAT is expertise, authoritativeness, and trustworthiness. If you missed our webinar where we went through the whole thing of EAT, you got to go watch it. If you want to rank on Google in 2020, you really, really, really need to know this stuff more than anything else. Google really cares about who the author is of the content to make sure it's reliable and not spammy content.
So we got a bunch of questions from that webinar, right? So we did the webinar, great. Got a bunch of questions in the comments. We wanted to take today to go through a bunch of those questions and just clarify a few things for you. So let's dive right into it.
T-stamps.
Yep.
Will authority sites be the standard for new website builders? Do small niche sites stand a chance still? So first of all, this is a distinction without a difference, right? Like authority site and niche site. Well, every authority site is on some niche. It's in some kind of industry, right? Yeah. And every niche site can become the authority on that topic, even if it's small. So first of all, I don't love that terminology, but I get the point.
Yeah.
He's saying, can we succeed with small sites or do we need to build big now? I would say there's a little bit of a change happening in the industry where you can still take a very small niche and fill it and become the authority on that very small thing. We just had a Project 24 member this morning, I read, got to $1,000 a month and was posting their milestone in a very, very small niche.
Yep.
And they just filled it. So yes, I absolutely think that can work. But generally, I would think a little bit bigger than we used to because of EAT. Because if you're going to go through all the work of establishing yourself of an authority, we might as well take a little bit bigger piece of the pie.
And I think that's the point. That's exactly what EAT is, right? It's establishing authoritativeness. It's establishing that you are an expert, even if it's in a fairly small and fairly specific niche. I would also say that what this means is we're not just going to write 30 articles and leave, mm-hmm. right? And we're not going to recommend that people build a website, write 30 articles, make another website with 30 articles, make another. You got to establish EAT over and over
Which
and over
Which is something
again.
We used to talk
yes,
about.
Yes, we did.
And we have a question on that topic. Someone asked us that exact same thing.
Right.
So we used to talk about that. 30 article site,
yep.
Set it out to the pasture, go to the next one.
Right.
So I totally agree with you that I would not recommend that strategy now.
In fact, in Project 24, we used to teach write 30 articles, create a second website, write 30 articles, and now decide which of the two you're going to move forward
with.
We
changed that January 1, 2019.
Yes, we did.
We changed that recommendation because of exactly this kind
yep.
of thing. Pick a niche, pick one you can stick with, and let's build that sucker. That's
yeah.
what we find the best results on. Are we still seeing people, even in Project 24, who are like, what do they know? And build multiple and are getting them to success? Yesterday, yes, we just
yeah.
talked to somebody yesterday who did that exact same thing. So can it work? Yes. But generally, you're going to be putting not quite enough into a bunch of different projects and none of them will quite ever take off. So I'd pick one and go all in.
Plus, it's just easier, right? The hardest part of any new website is being new,
mm-hmm.
right? It's that ghost town phase when you don't have any expertise, authoritativeness, and trustworthiness with Google. That's what causes the ghost town phase. They don't know who you are yet. They don't know if you're trustworthy yet, so they're testing your content. Once you've busted through that on one site, why start over again?
Mm-hmm.
Just go add some more content to that first site and build up your authoritativeness in that particular space.
Yep.
All right, next question. Teach us how to write About Us page.
I noticed you skipped his name.
I did.
So come on.
Okay.
Try that out.
And I'm sorry. I apologize. But it is, I think it's Girish Radhakrishnan. So
excellent
thank
name.
You, Girish. Thank you for the question.
Okay. First, you can go look at an example
yeah.
on Income School. Go into the footer and click the About Jim Harmer. I don't think you've put yours together
I
yet.
Haven't,
we
but
need
I will
to get
see.
Yours together. And that's an example of one, but I mean, mostly just look at the type of content that's there. Don't necessarily worry about
the design,
yeah. and everything. It doesn't have to be fancy. Just get the content out there. I mean, just think if somebody were to sit you down and say, what do you know about your topic? What kind of things could you tell them?
Mm-hmm.
Put everything that could be relevant. Like on a camper website, we have a website about RVs. I have never been to like school. I didn't get a major in college in RVs, right? But I own a camper and I go camping with my family like 25 nights
a year. And you've owned a couple of different types of campers. Uh-huh. And so you probably have more knowledge than a lot of people.
I'm going to have pictures of me camping with my family out there. I'm going to write that I've owned a few different campers and I go camping 25 nights a year. And that's as much of an authority as you could really expect on an RV website.
What that does is it does make it a little bit more difficult if you're starting up a website where you don't have any real experience and you can't take any photos of you. This also makes it really hard for those people that just make this straight up Amazon product review websites for products they've never tried. The nice thing is, though, it means that if you do put in the effort, you have crossed this barrier that 99% of website creators are never going to be willing to cross. Mm-hmm. You have actually established real authoritativeness and trustworthiness, and because of that, you have a much higher likelihood of success.
Right, so what's changed it for SEO in 2020? Well, where you used to be able to make an archery site and have never touched a bow, you should probably go buy a darn bow and shoot the dang thing every once in a while now.
Like somebody,
it's not that hard. You don't have to be an Olympic archer to make a website. Just be real and authentic. All of us want that. You don't want us making this channel if we weren't authentically doing what we're teaching, right?
Yeah.
So do the same thing. You can do it. It's not that hard.
I saw a troll comment the other day on an old video of ours where we talked about how you know, when we were creating Snake Owner. One of the things that we recommend you would do if you're going to make a pet snake website is go buy a pet snake. Mm-hmm. And their comment was something like, worst SEO advice ever. Absolutely not. This is not the worst SEO advice ever. In fact, it's some of the best. Mm-hmm. If you're going to get into an industry that you don't know much about, you need to go get into the industry. Otherwise, you won't have EAT.
In addition to the EAT, like just understanding the search analysis and the mind of a searcher helps so much. Very frequently when we've started new websites, like the first 10 articles that I just think of in my head, like, ooh, I know people are searching this. Like before I even do anything on the computer, just I know that I would search that or I have searched that for real. Often 8 out of 10 of those end up being the best articles because it's something that the tools aren't finding, whatever, but you know people are wondering and you know how to express it in the way that they would. It just works. But so just get involved in what you're doing.
Exactly. And if you're not the expert yet, that's actually okay. Mm-hmm. What I really like about that is you can look at the topic from the perspective of the beginner and you know what questions they have. Something that an expert usually forgets. They forget what it was like to not know. So don't be worried if you're not like the supreme expert yet. But let's go work on building up that actual experience.
And it's going to be more fun. Like when we were working on that pantry preparedness website, oh my goodness, it was like pulling teeth to write those blog posts. It was painful because I'm just not into that.
Yeah.
Okay. All right. Rodrigo Olivares says, basically he has a bunch of different writers on different platforms. He's got them from iWriter, Hoth, ProBlogger, etc. How do they tie back the author's profile?
Well, it says like you don't necessarily have an author to tie it back to. If there's no author to tie it back to, then he probably is having them ghostwrite for him as well.
Yeah, and I think that's great.
Yep.
So have some personality, probably you, who's the face of the website, and then just have them ghostwrite for you. I mean, ghostwriting has been around forever. Some of the biggest names in every industry use ghostwriters. It's very common. Just make sure when you get that article, you aren't just pressing publish. Put it in your voice. Add in a little anecdote. Make sure the content is correct. Put it out there.
This may surprise you, but very few politicians have actually written a book.
That's true.
Many books and blog posts are written by ghostwriters. It's perfectly okay to do that. But yes, you do need to tie it back to somebody. Whether it's you, really you, or a persona that you create, and then you need to establish EAT for that persona or for you as a person.
Okay, now this one we just barely talked about, the set it and forget it kind of website with 30 articles. Can it work? Yeah, but you have to get everything right. And
right.
I the people that I have seen succeed with building multiple over and over again are people who are just really good at this.
Yeah.
They can nail the search analysis and 9 out of 10 articles they put on there, they have selected one that they know they can win, they can write it in a way that they can win, and they picked a topic that has search volume, and they can start over and over and over again, and it's a cakewalk, and they can start these sites and work. So could you still do that today? 30 articles and succeed? Yep. Do we see it? Yep. Will most people fail doing it? Yeah.
Especially if it's your first site.
Yeah, you're just going to make mistakes. Give yourself some margin and plan on a bigger site so that if you miss on 15, 20 articles, you're still okay.
So Tom Simpson is asking, how does EAT work if you have a site in a YMYL niche? So his particularly medical related. And basically what he's doing is he's taking complicated medical terms, right? And complicated medical procedures and putting them in layman's terms. He's not a doctor, but he's got tons of practice and experience.
So I'm searching vasectomy.
Yeah.
And this guy just puts it in layman's terms.
This is how it works. This is what your experience is going to be like.
So if I am considering a vasectomy, is that the content I want to see? Or would I prefer to see a nicely, you know, clearly written for the layman from somebody who's an expert?
That's the thing.
I would definitely want to hear from a doctor. I also, you know, he's watering it down for me. There is value in that.
Yep.
But he could be watering down some important parts. Like what if there's a high risk of a side effect that he doesn't mention and stuff? This is too mission critical to get involved with.
Yeah.
I don't think this is a good idea.
The other thing with this is that Google isn't really going to know the difference, right? Google's not going to necessarily know the difference between your layman's terms article and the doctor's article that's maybe a little bit too technical, right? Mm-hmm. And the one that's the doctor is the one Google's going to look at and say, this one's right. Mm-hmm. Like, this one may not be quite as user-friendly, but I'm confident this one's right. And so if you're going to do something like this, you've got to get a doctor on board. Mm-hmm. You know?
I totally agree.
And you've got to establish high EAT for that doctor, and they need to be,
reviewing
the content, and it is going to be very difficult.
It's just so mission critical, that search, that this is just going to be a hard one to break in.
Sev says, about Embora Pets, does snake care count as an EAT type website? How do you show your reliable source of info if you're writing the content and you don't have a degree in caring for them? I don't know that there's a degree in caring for snakes, but there's...
Veterinarian.
Yeah, well, yeah, okay, sure. Would it be better if the content was written by a veterinarian? Possibly.
Yeah. What I would say here is I think we're not doing a very good job on EAT with Embora Pets. In the QRG, the Google's Quality Rater Guidelines, they don't specifically list pets in the YMYL section, but as we read it this most recent time, it's like nice reading for us. It's like, this is so great. As we're reading through it, like that's the thing we all said is like, yeah, they don't mention pets specifically, but we all know pets is a mission critical kind of search for, you know, the health of a pet.
Yeah.
And so, yeah, we do need to step it up there. And we've talked about some ways that we can do that. But I agree. I don't think we're doing a very good job with EAT on that website right now.
Well, and that's exactly right. Like, so how do we establish credibility if we're not a veterinarian? Well, if you can establish credibility as a pet owner, you establish the credibility the same way you would anything else, right?
Yeah, have the pet link to a scholarly article instead of some random thing. You know, you're linking to actual scientific things. You could go on Upwork and get a veterinarian to approve the articles and put his name on it. Uh-huh. There's so many small steps you could take to doing it.
Exactly.
Now, if you have an English terrier and your website is about English terriers and you're just writing all about it, don't feel like you have to hire a veterinarian if you're going to succeed in 2020.
Well, because most of your content's not...
You have an English terrier. Yeah, again, partially an expert.
So, and that's an important distinction. Like, there's a lot of content about pets that is not about the health of the pet. It's about
what's the temperament
of
an English terrier.
Exactly.
An owner's a great source for that.
It's probably a better source than a veterinarian in many cases. And this falls into the category of everyday knowledge, everyday expertise. And mm-hmm. Google has specifically said... many, many, many topics, everyday expertise is perfectly valid for EAT.
Now, that's a good point that you bring up because it's not as if entire industries are like blacklisted. Yeah. Oop, YMYL, not YMYL. There may be some that are entirely YMYL, like personal finance. I don't know how you write something in that space that's not YMYL, right?
But
YMYL means your money, your life. It's just one of these very important searches that Google wants to make sure it gets right. But in virtually every niche, there are some topics that would be YMYL. Example, English Terriers. English Terrier temperament, no, just an owner's perspective on that is great. Are English Terriers good with kids? An owner's perspective is great. The vast majority are. Mm-hmm. But something like there's a lump on my English Terrier's side, maybe that is more mission critical, and maybe that is getting a little pet medical, and maybe that is going to require a little bit more EAT. I also have a personal belief that there's a gradient here, and it's not black and white, this term is, this term isn't. I think there's a gradient of how mission critical is this search.
And here's the other thing too. When it comes to EAT, it's like helping Google decide between two or three different pieces of, or thousands of different pieces of content. If you're writing about topics where there's just nothing out there, you'll still get to rank number one because relevance is the most important search criterion. So highly relevant content, if you do good search analysis, like you can get around this. The problem is gonna be if, you know, 6 months, a year, 2 years down the road, you know, some veterinarian comes and writes that same article, you might lose that. And so that's where establishing EAT is not only going to help you with rankings in the short term, it's going to future-proof your website as well.
Okay, we're talking about a lot of nitty-gritty details of EAT and stuff, and just don't let this slow you down or scare you in any way. 99.9% of website owners and the other bloggers in your niche have never heard of this, are not clued into this, and have no idea what to be working on. And so, to have an idea about this, do what you can do, and then move on. Make great content, and it's going to be okay. Don't let this like scare you. Oh, 2020, I can't do anything. It's not like that. If you're a Project 24 member, we have the 30 steps laid out for you of like, from most important to least important. You just walk through it, go through step by step, and you should be set to go to never think about EAT hardly ever again.
Yeah, pretty much. With the exception of if you're like in a highly YMYL category.
You might want to go through there a few times.
Well, and you may want to go like, every month or two, I'm going to try to get on another podcast or whatever. But seriously, for the vast majority of you, if you go through those 30 steps and just do those one time, you're done. Just set it and forget it and move on, write your content, and don't even think about it again.
Ashwin Joy says, what do you think about EAT in the programming niche? Again, I would say there's nothing like super mission critical about this one, but there could be some topics like, should I pay $100,000 to go to school to get a degree in computer programming? Well, that one is YMYL.
It is, yeah.
So again, specific things, not an entire industry. Yeah.
And again, like if the content isn't YMYL, let's just go through the basic steps to establish EAT anyway.
Sure, yes.
There's no harm in doing that, and it's not gonna take you that much time. Carl Broadbent, a friend of ours, he asks, I entered the URL search to check my EAT, and it came up with about me and my affiliate disclaimer. No other information about his authoritativeness. And he's been working in this industry for over 30 years. He's asking, is that possibly affecting
his
rankings?
Such a good question.
It's a great question.
So the issue here is you can be an expert secretly, right? Like, let's say I have been a woodworker for 30 years, and I know everything there is to know about woodworking, right? But if I don't take the steps to show Google that in a way that can be algorithmically measured, it doesn't matter.
Right.
None of it really matters as far as EAT is concerned. And so you have to take some active steps to do some personal branding, some personal marketing for your website. We need to think a little bit less about just creating content and putting it out into the ether. And then now we're like, you know, we do need to do a little bit of branding for yourself. It's not like some kind of massive shift that you can't get over and suddenly it's twice as hard. There are just some common sense steps you need to take to do a little bit of personal and branding for your organization and for you in order to rank.
Yep, absolutely.
I didn't explain very well the answer to his question. So yes, you are, but now, you know, go get on a podcast.
Right.
Go get on a YouTube video.
Go do a YouTube
video.
Collaboration with somebody on somebody else's channel.
Yeah, just some very basic things that can let Google rank that.
Exactly. So Pip and I is asking, from a medical perspective, what about home remedies? How does EAT play here? So we talked about like how Google said that even in YMYL spaces, there is a certain amount of like everyday expertise that you can have. Mm-hmm. And home remedies, if these are not being talked about by medical professionals, then like the most authoritative people are the people who are doing this, right?
Yeah, if I search home remedies for a flu,
yeah,
somebody who just does this at home, absolutely an expert.
But there are some people that are more expert at this than others, right? Mm-hmm. There are some people who have established themselves as, you know, credible sources of information in the home remedy space. And they do that by having a YouTube channel and being out there and doing collaborations with others. And, mm-hmm. you know, maybe you're the home remedy person, but you get on the YouTube channel of a really like really, really successful essential oils person. Mm-hmm. And you talk about home remedies using essential oils on their channel. You get on some podcasts talking about this kind of stuff. You need to establish that credibility so that Google can look at you and say, okay, this isn't just some quack who's just coming up with home remedies. This is this is someone who other people
I haven't heard that in a long time.
This is someone who other people trust uh-huh. for home remedy source as a source of home remedy information.
Good point.
Cool.
Eric says, so that means are you going away from your no link building recommendation? Such a good question.
Yeah.
So no, we're not.
No.
We are building the websites the way Google wants us to build the websites. Google's like really upfront about what a successful site looks like to them, and they have thousands of engineers and a lot of effort they put into making sure the sites that they want to rank go up, right? And so we're not interested in trying to manipulate Google search results by getting a bunch of spammy links and stuff. It's going to do more harm than good, and it's going to waste your time, right? What we are talking about is, so I mentioned something like, you know, get on a podcast, etc. Uh-huh. Do I want them to link to my website? Well, yes, I want. Of course I want them to send leads to me, right? But it's not it's just marketing.
It's branding. Send me a lead, right? Mm-hmm. This is, hey, maybe I did write a guest post, right?
Mm-hmm.
And in this guest post that's super highly relevant for a good audience, like very related audience, and this guest post is maybe going to send people to my website because mm-hmm. my website is highly relevant to them. But what we're not doing is necessarily trying to build a bunch of links to an article to try to boost that article in the SERPs.
Mm-hmm.
What we're trying to do is become a credible source of information in an industry. And so oftentimes, like if we are going to link or have a no link mention,
mm-hmm.
it's going to say, you know, Jim Harmer from Camper Report, or maybe it is a link to Camper Report, but it's a link to Jim Harmer's about page or the Camper Report organization's about page
exactly.
on the website, so that we establish credibility for the site, the organization, and the author, Jim Harmer.
So John Doe, asked a couple different questions, but is Jim Harmer a camper expert? Well, we talked about this, about the everyday expert. And so you can settle that, I think, pretty well. I mean, do I manufacture RVs and have been? No, I'm not that. But I have owned quite a few campers and camped a lot in them.
Yeah.
And so, yeah, okay. Now, is all of this necessary? I'm kind of going backwards on purpose. Is all of this necessary? Well, if you want to rank on Google, it is. If you want people to trust the information that you put out, then yes, it is. Is it as necessary in some niches as others? No, because some people just, it's not as mission critical of a topic. Now, the last part of this, is a lot of personal branding doesn't sound very passive. And that's what we want to correct here. Again, if you're a Project 24 member, just go through the 30 steps, and in a lot of niches,
done.
You're done.
Yeah,
you've done as much personal branding as anybody could expect.
Take Camper Report through those 30 steps, it's done,
mm-hmm.
right? You don't need to go on a bunch of podcasts to build up credibility as somebody who uses a camper.
Right. If I want to be known as America's personal finance expert, right? Forget that Google even exists. If I want to be known as that, that would be a tall order. I would need to do a lot of personal branding. And in that case, is it very passive? No, not really.
No.
It's something I'm going to have to work on for a long time if I want to become America's personal brand, personal, whatever you call it, the personal finance expert, right?
Yeah.
And so just think of it in that terms. Think of it in terms of, if there were no Google, how could I be an expert in my space? And if it's quilting, I quilt a lot.
Yeah.
And if it's personal finance, maybe you do want to work towards some certifications. Maybe you do want to get out there and go to a couple conferences and do some different things. Think of it without Google and you're going to do a great job.
Here's the thing about passiveness and websites, okay?
Passivity.
if you are in a like heavily YMYL space, personal finance and like straight up medical content especially, and then there's some others around that, but those particularly, and even like news and politics, there's nothing passive about any one of those. And that has been true for a long time.
Very good point.
So if you were making a site about pontoon boats and, you know, the best tube to pull behind a pontoon boat, that can still be very passive. Now, the only difference between now and 2 years ago when you created that site is that now we'd probably make an about page that says, "Hi, I'm Jim Harmer, and look at the pontoon boat that I bought." You know?
Right.
Like, that's about the only difference here for that level, for that type of website.
I'm sorry, I'm laughing because somebody commented on our last YouTube video that when you talk, it's like I'm boring a hole through your head with my like, eyes. And now it's like, where do I look? He's talking. I want to look at him. So I like was just staring at the wall over here, and I don't know what that accomplishes. You guys are making me self-conscious. All right, we want to do a review of one of your websites to kind of show what things to look for in a successful site and how to build it up. And to do that, go to incomeschool.com/site review, and we'll have a little form that you can submit there so that we can get the information we need about your site, and we'll pick one or a couple of you to review your sites live on this YouTube channel. Thanks everybody for your support, and have an awesome Monday.